Trust in Him completely and take each step believing as a child. God will provide beyond what we imagine, so much more than we could fathom. He will supply, God will provide when we trust in Him completely. Take each step believing as a child. God will provide beyond what we imagine, so much more than we could fathom. He will supply, God will provide when we trust in Him completely and take each step believing as a child.
Constantly attending, He's protecting and defending, delivering on promises He made. With a watchful eye that never sleeps, my Father guards and keeps me. He's faithful, my God is faithful.
Faithfully. Praise the Lord. Jesus can help me. Jesus alone. Amen. Did you ever put your faith in something that let you down? If you put it in Christ, He will never let you down. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, I thank You for the privilege of prayer. And I pray this morning as we talk about that subject that we might be inspired, that we might be challenged to renew our commitment to communicate with You through this wonderful privilege. Help us, Father, in so many areas of our life, Lord. We just need to go to You and just make that as if it were breathing, as natural as possible. In Jesus' name, amen. And you may be seated. Great to see you this morning. Thank you for being here. I'm going to be preaching this morning on prayer. And as you can tell, we've sang two songs so far on prayer. And our third song we're going to sing, hopefully you got a bulletin. Inside that bulletin is a hymn called Did You Think to Pray? And if you didn't get that, we're going to sing that after a while. If I could have a couple ushers that are ready to can come down here and grab these from me. If you didn't get that song in your hymnal, I want to make sure you have it so that when Brother Brown comes back up here after the choir special, you have it and are ready to go. Do I have any ushers that are available? Thank you, Brother Brown. I appreciate that. If you did not get this song, can you raise your hand? I just want to make sure you have it. There's a couple over here. Raise your hand, keep it up high, and while they're getting that to you, I will make the announcements. All right? Very good. I have my tithe envelope, so I don't forget to give. Now, prayer request. Please pray for Mrs. Titus. She is having surgery this Tuesday, and I know that she would appreciate your prayers. This morning, I had sent out an email. I don't know that you check your emails on Sunday morning, but I just felt a lot of the Lord. I had been thinking between yesterday and today about the situation in Israel, and how many of you are aware about the Israel situation, at least to some extent. As you know, depending on your source of information, it can be difficult to know or how to make sense of what's going on in the world. And we as Christians and believers, we know that Israel is very significant in God's sovereign plan. And, you know, what can we do? We can certainly be mindful of it. We can pray for them. We can pray that God would just... His who He is would be made known to the world. Here's the thing, you know, we were talking about in Sunday school about this idea of Jesus was talking in John 10 about, if you don't believe Me, believe the works. There's so much evidence in this world that points to who God is. Brother Kidd had talked about this this thing of skepticism and believing truth. And the thing is, why, what's the big deal about Israel? It's just this little rinky-dink country. What is the big deal? Because Him. Because of God. And, hey, about this thing about not being able to make sense and what's true and what's not true. Remember the Bible says something about wars? You know, I never really took the gravity of the next statement and rumors of wars. You know, there's a lot of rumors. You know, who knows what's true? Who knows exactly what's really going on? Well, I know what's true, and that book is true right there. And so anyway, keep your eyes on Jesus. Pray for God's chosen people. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. That's a command in God's word. And hey, let's occupy. Let's serve the Lord. Let's do the will of God with our lives to the best of our ability, and just pray for God's will to be done. So pray for Israel. Pray for... Brother Gere had mentioned to me in the back room that he has an aunt and an uncle that live in Israel. Pray for them. Their names are Jay and Kathy Ross. Pray for them that the Lord would protect them. And then those folks that, you know, we are supporting there, you'll know who they are. They're out on our missions plaque. So please pray just about that situation. Be mindful of it. I would appreciate that. I did want to say a word about the girls' soccer team. Man, it was a blessing to be there yesterday at the tournament. I was so proud, if I could use that word, of those young ladies. First of all, from a soccer perspective, and just the effort and the poise and the way they played. You know, some teams, they just boot the ball down the field, hope for a breakaway and get lucky. And our girls just played really beautiful soccer. And of course, that starts at the top with the coaching and the teaching. It starts with the just all of the time and the effort, not just during the season, but those Sunday nights that they went down there in the gym and just worked on stuff in the winter and the spring, and just they worked so hard and came this close to winning first place. But last year they'd come in third. This year they came in second. They lost the final game 4-3. And in the final minute, could have tied it with a ball hitting the crossbar. But it was they did so well. And the game before the final, they played Southeast, and they were down 2-0 at halftime. And they clawed their way back. They didn't get discouraged. They just kept playing hard, and you should have seen, they prayed together, they trusted God, they gave it their best effort, they didn't complain and whine about things that didn't go their way, they just kept pushing, and they worked together as a great team, and ended up coming back, tying it, went into overtime, into a shootout, and I think they had some angels with them, helping them during the shootout, and maybe affecting the other team a little bit, and anyway, it was awesome to watch. I was so encouraged and blessed by their effort. Congratulations, young ladies. For your success, and I do thank you even more so for your testimony, for representing our church just the way you did. I was just very moved by your testimony, and how just the teams, the other churches, they love our girls, and they just they root for them. People come up to me and they say, you know, they want us to win, and that's a blessing. So praise the Lord for that. Now, the flag football tournament is coming up on Saturday morning, October the 22nd, and that'll again start at 9 a.m. Please, if you can, come out to root for our boys. They've worked hard as well as they prepared this fall. Pray for that. Tonight, Brother Kidd's going to be bringing the message, so I'm excited about that. Pray for him as he preaches to us. This Wednesday evening, Brother Case is going to be speaking on the principles of music, and so that'll be a blessing. I'm looking forward to that. And this coming Sunday, a week from today, I'm not going to be here. My wife and I are going to be out of town. We're going to be going up to Rhode Island to attend a conference on Monday and Tuesday, but we're going to go early. We haven't gotten away in a long time, so I'm looking forward to that. Brother Kidd's going to preach next Sunday morning, and then next Sunday night we've got a 3-man tag team preaching event. So you're not going to want to miss that. That'll be a blessing. You may notice around the building here a fly or two. Anybody happen to notice those? It's just it's something we experience this time of year. It's funny to hear people talk about, like, this is the first year we've ever had flies. But that's just not the case. At this time of year, we've always had them. And we just got to get through it and just clean them up. And if there's anyone that wants to be a blessing, and you're willing to get here maybe an hour before service, they accumulate throughout the week, and the worst thing about it is when people step on and they get ground into the carpet or whatever. If you'd like to come and help us, somebody's gonna do it, but if you'd like to help with that, that's just like a ministry you'd like to have. It doesn't have to be you every time. If you're willing to come in on a Sunday or a Sunday morning early or a Wednesday evening, that would be a blessing and helpful. Thank you. Let me know if you'd like to come do that. Just to let you know, at the end of the month, I should say the beginning of next month, I'm not going to announce this every week, but I just want, hopefully you can get this on your calendar. Senator Pam Helming has asked for us to host a Veterans Hall of Fame on Thursday, November the 2nd from 4 to 6. They're going to meet down in the gym, and families in the Wayne County area, I think it's in Oliver, I'm not sure. Anyway, in this area, they nominate their loved ones that are veterans to get in this Hall of Fame that she has, and they take a couple hours and honor them down in the gymnasium. And so you're welcome to come to that, but I want you to know that that's going to happen. And the reason why I bring that up is because we're going to need your help because they wanted it on that day, but on the very next day, Friday, the November the 3rd, starts our Missions Ephesus weekend. And we're going to have the gym all decorated for the Missions Conference theme. And so we're going to have to make a switch on Thursday night after that's over. So I'm just hoping we can have a bunch of people help with tearing down the patriotic decorations, then putting up the harvest theme decorations. And our Missions Emphasis theme is going to be a heart for the harvest. And so be mindful of that. We're going to have special meetings on that Friday night, Saturday morning, Saturday night, and then all day Sunday. I'll tell you more about that as the time gets closer, and then we'll renew our faith promise missions commitment. This coming Thursday, we're having a homeschool group field trip to the Genesee Country Museum, Thursday, October the 12th. The bus is going to leave here around 8:45, return approximately 3. So the event there is from 10 to 2. It is $10 per student up to 18 years of age, and then $12 per chaperone. Please sign up in the foyer if you plan to come to that. There is going to be a teen harvest party Saturday, October the 14th from 2 to 4:30 here at the church. Young adults are welcome. Ask Brother Luke if you have any questions about that. And that's enough announcements for this morning. I appreciate your patience with that. I did want to recognize any visitors we have with us today. It's good to have Chris, right? No. That's what I said. Tristan. Tristan, this is Mrs. Drecke's grandson. This is Sean's son, Tristan. Good to have you. If you could give him a guest card there, and we've got a gift for you to have, and if you would be willing to fill that out so we could have a record of your visit, we would be very happy to have that. Thank you so much for being here. And then it's good to have my niece, Amy, and nephew-in-law, Marco, good to have you all visiting with us today. And then Courtney's here today somewhere. I think I saw her wandering around. Make sure you greet them before they take off. Good to have our family visiting in town this weekend. Anybody else here visiting that is here for the first time? I think that's everyone. All right, we'll have a choir special at this time.
Sky was veiled in Everybody have one of these songs from their bulletin? Let's all stand. We'll sing, Did You Think to Pray? On the last verse, we're going to sing this last line through twice.
We do pray now you bless this offering and help us, Father, to be faithful with that which you give, to be wise stewards, and the Lord help us to have a cheerful countenance about us when we give to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Heaven could begin.
start, and when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go. I would face forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. Forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace.
Amen. Turn in your Bible, if you would, to James chapter 5. James chapter 5. And after all these weeks, we're finally come to the concluding message in the book of James. I've thoroughly enjoyed this study, and each lesson being marks of maturity. There's one thing I desire for myself and for you all, is that we would be mature in our faith, that we would be complete in Christ, as James says, wanting nothing. And in James chapter 5, and we'll read the final verses beginning in verse 13 all the way down through verse 20. And we're going to speak this morning on the priority of prayer. James 5 and verse 13, he says, "Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let him pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much." Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death, and shall hide a multitude of sins. And let's pray. Father, I thank you for the word of God, and thank you for the impact that it has in our lives, and the stability that it brings in a world that's filled with that which is unsure. Help us to look to your word in faith this morning, and may we all grow and receive some practical encouragement. In Jesus' name, amen. We've learned many lessons from this book so far about the different marks of maturity and what the mature Christian does as they take God's word and practically apply it to their life. And as a matter of review, in each lesson we've learned, one, that the mature believer turns trials into triumphs. Instead of a difficulty becoming a stumbling block, they use it as a stepping stone. Mature believer knows how to handle temptation. None of us completely has the victory over it, but we understand the principles of avoiding temptation and seeking the Lord's help in those times. The mature believer is genuine.
The mature believer loves each person who walks in the door. The mature believer is not a respecter of persons. The mature believer has a dynamic faith in that he doesn't just talk about what he believes, but he demonstrates what he believes by his or her actions. Mature believer yields his tongue to the Lord. Well, that's a difficult one. He seeks wisdom from above. He's humble before God. He is generous. Last week we spoke on the power of patience, and today, the priority of prayer. I want to get out something for you. As a matter of illustration, I have in my office a diffuser. How many of you know what this is? Anybody have one of these in your house? How many like things to smell good? Anyway, these are supposed to not only smell good, but supposed to be good for you, right? I don't know. I don't know if it's just in my head or what. But I want to show you something. I don't know if this will hit home or not, but I thought about it and I thought I'd use this. So, all right, you may or may not be able to see something coming out of here. You see that? Got that? All right, smells good too. Smells good up here. You like that? You want to come up here? No, don't do that. So the point is, you know, the Word of God speaks of in the temple about the altar of incense and how that was to be continually going, and there was an aroma, there was a fragrance, there was a mixture that was only to be used in the temple. But that incense altar and that aroma that would ascend was to be symbolic of the prayers of the saints coming before God. And I just want to encourage you today that as you consider that and as you see this image here, that would to God that as our Heavenly Father viewed our life and looked it upon our life, that He would see a people that continually offer prayers to Him. We often speak of the importance of a time with God, and that is of utmost importance, to have that priority of that appointment, that time we set aside that's just for Him and Him alone. And perhaps we use the model prayer in Luke 11 to outline what we say to God during that time. But there is an attitude of prayer, that prayer, pray without ceasing, that Paul told the Thessalonians, that it would become as natural as breathing for us. That the Lord could look at our lives as He monitors us from the portals of heaven and smell that aroma of our dependence upon Him. Whatever it is that you go through on a daily basis, circumstantial relationships, just moment by moment, may our actions and our reactions be continually a prayer to God. God, help me with this. God, give me wisdom in this situation. And yes, God gives us a brain. And yes, God gives us principles and He gives us abilities to navigate and to govern life, but may those decisions that we make and actions that we take always be immersed in that incense of our dependence, of voicing a cry to God daily, weekly, moment by moment. May God smell the aroma of our prayers. Prayer is certainly a high and holy privilege. It's the most amazing thing that we can do, that we can walk into the throne room of heaven in the presence of the King and present our petitions. You remember the story of Esther and how when Mordecai told her to go before the king, and she was concerned because she wasn't called to go before the king, and if he didn't hold out the scepter, her life may be in danger. But you and I can walk into the presence of God any moment to know that because of the blood of Christ and because of our relationship with God, we are always welcomed into the throne room of God. And you are accepted in the Beloved, not because of who you are or what you've done, but because of who Jesus Christ is. And I want to say to those of you who do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you're not sure of where you'd spend eternity, if you don't know if you have a relationship with God and your sins are forgiven and the Spirit of God doesn't bear witness with your spirit, you're just not sure about that, you're missing out, and God wants to welcome you in His presence, but He'll only do that if you come through the door, which is Jesus Christ. He invites you. Come. John Bunyan said, "He who runs from God in the morning will scarcely find Him the rest of the day." Robert Murray McShane said, "What a man is on his knees before God, that he is, and nothing else." A tale is told about a small town that had historically been dry. If you don't know what that means, it means alcohol was illegal. But then a local businessman decided to build a tavern. A group of Christians from a local church were concerned and planned an all-night prayer meeting to ask God to intervene. It just so happened that shortly after the prayer meeting, lightning struck the bar and burned it to the ground. The owner of the bar sued the church, claiming that the prayers of the congregation were responsible. But the church hired a lawyer to argue in court that they were not responsible. The presiding judge, after his initial review of the case, stated that no matter how this case comes out, one thing is clear. The tavern owner believes in prayer and the Christians do not. The mature Christian is prayerful in troubles of life. Instead of complaining about a situation, he talks to God about it. Talking to the Lord in prayer is certainly a mark of spiritual maturity. And as we conclude the series of lessons through the book of James, perhaps the last lesson is the most important lesson. James encourages us to pray by describing four situations. Number one, prayer in affliction. Prayer in affliction. Verse 13 says, "Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray." The word afflicted there means suffering in difficult circumstances. It speaks of suffering. You know, perhaps there's something going on in your life today that hurts. It just hurts. Maybe it's a memory of something that happened in the past. Maybe it's something that is just ongoing in your life. Mental, physical. I want to encourage you today that if you're suffering, if you're afflicted, if there's something that you're carrying that's tough, pray. Pray about it. We must not grumble. We must not complain or criticize our fellow brethren or maybe become covetous because it appears that their life may be easier than ours. The Bible says in James 5:9, and just a few verses before, he says, "Grudge not one against another, brethren." First of all, you don't know what somebody else is going through. I don't know everything that's going on in this church, but I do have the privilege and the burden to know that there are many people in this church that carry heavy weight in their life. But you don't know it. And to a degree, there's no way that we all could ever carry each other's burdens totally. And thankfully, that's why we have a Lord that's omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. Because folks, I could never have the wisdom or the ability to give you the comfort that He can give you. He's faithful, and He will not forget what it is that you go through. And He is perfectly capable and able to help meet your needs in those difficult times. But we do need to be less self-focused and to realize that there are people among us that suffer and to be mindful of them, to be an encouragement to them. But pray about your afflictions. Take it to the Lord. We certainly should never get bitter against the Lord. Trust the Lord. You know, we talked about in Sunday school about Lazarus, God's divine timetable, and how folks, it appeared to folks that Jesus was late, appeared to folks that someone was suffering needlessly. But you just don't know. You can't see the end yet. God has a plan. And in the first chapter of James, we learn that when we go through difficulty, he says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. And perhaps the Lord can give you the understanding that you need to get through moment by moment each and every day. But I want to encourage you to pray. And if you don't get an answer and if you don't understand, trust Him. He loves you. He is doing what He's doing for a reason. He's allowing what He's allowing for a reason. And ultimately, His plan is to bring honor and glory to Himself. And He wants to do that through your life. Because it's when He's lifted up that people can be helped. When He's lifted up that people can be reached. I was reading this morning in 1 Samuel 17, and when David was preparing to go to fight Goliath, a phrase stuck out in that text where he said, first of all, that the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. But then one thing stuck out to me after that. He says, and this assembly shall know that the Lord delivereth, not by sword. See, sometimes it's important that the earth may know, that the lost may know, that those seeking truth may know. But you know, every once in a while, it's good for the people of God to know, to be reminded that it's not our ability, it's not our strength, it's not our gifts, it's Him. Through weak, feeble, yielded people. In our hardest moments, God wants to use your testimony to be a light to the lost. Prayer can remove affliction. Don't get me wrong. We often, as preachers, speak about, you know, trusting God through the affliction. Hey, why not try to pray about it? Maybe God will take it away as a result of your prayers. He said in James 4, verse 2, he said, you have not because you ask not. You never know. Maybe if you bring it, maybe God's just waiting to unload a blessing on you, that if you just pray about it and ask Him, He would answer your prayer. But if He doesn't answer it the way you ask, we always have to trust Him. He knows what's best. So what difficult circumstance do you find yourself under today? What affliction? Is it some relationship that you have that, you know, that can be some of the heaviest stuff? When there's someone you care about, someone you love, and man, there's a misunderstanding, or there's just you're at odds with each other, and you just desire so badly for there to be reconciliation. And sometimes it's out of your hands. It's something that somebody else needs to do. Pray about it. Pray for them. Don't give up. Maybe it's a financial issue, a burden that you're under. You know, maybe you've got yourself in a bind. Maybe it's fruitlessness. You're praying for God to use you. You're praying for God's blessing on your ministry, and you just don't see Him working. You don't see the results that you'd like to see. Pray. Keep praying. Some random need, a vehicle, a job. I don't know what it is today, but if you're afflicted, pray. It's interesting how right after that, after he says, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Then he says, is any merry? Let him sing psalms. You know, sometimes we're all at different stages, right? Maybe one day you're afflicted and your brother over here is merry. And maybe the tables will turn on another day. We certainly should never feel like we can't rejoice because somebody else is suffering. Sometimes we can feel guilty about being happy and joyful and blessed, but that's not what God intends. Hey, if you're afflicted, pray. If you're merry, hey, sing psalms. Because you know what? Those people that are afflicted, they need your song. They need your song. They need to know that there is light at the end of the tunnel. They need to know that you got through your affliction and now you're merry. So praise the Lord for that. William Waldorf was blind, but this did not render him ineffective for God. On the contrary, as he sat by the fire in his English home in the mid-19th century, his hands kept busy whittling out useful objects such as shoehorns. His mind was active too. Called on to preach from time to time in a rural English church, William Walford composed sermons in his head to deliver on Sundays. He memorized a huge amount of the Bible, which he quoted verbatim in his sermons. Some of his folks thought he had memorized the entire scripture cover to cover. William also composed lines of verse, and he prayed. Thomas Salmon, a New York native, spent time in Coles Hill, Warwickshire, England, where he became acquainted with William. He tells this tale of what happened one day while he was visiting the blind lay preacher. He repeated two or three pieces which he had composed, and having no friend at home to commit them to paper, he had laid them up in the storehouse within. "How will this do?" asked he, as he repeated the following lines with a complacent smile, touched with some light lines of fear lest he subjects himself to criticism. I rapidly copied the lines with my pencil as he uttered them and sent them for insertion in the Observer, which was a local newspaper, if they were to think them worthy of preservation. The Observer did consider them worthy of preservation. In this afflicted man, his poem was published September 13, 1845. His poem reads this: "Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, that calls me from a world of care, and bids me at my Father's throne make all my wants and wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief, and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, the joys I feel, the bliss I share, of those whose anxious spirits burn with strong desires for thy return. With such I hasten to the place where God my Savior shows his face, and gladly take my station there and wait for thee, sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, thy wings shall my petition bear to him whose truth and faithfulness engage the waiting soul to bless, and since he bids me seek his face, believe his word and trust his grace, I'll cast on him my every care and wait for thee, sweet hour of prayer." So number one, prayer and affliction. Number two, prayer for the sick. He said in verse 14, "Is any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him." James was not giving us a blanket formula for healing the sick, as if we were just to follow this and call for the elders and pray, then they're going to be healed. A prayer of faith is an act of submission to the will of God. You see, no matter what God does, no matter how God answers, God is never on trial. God is not good because he answers prayers the way we ask. God is not strong because he answers prayers the way they ask. He is strong regardless, and his ways are higher than our ways. But this is a call for God to his people to realize that when you have struggles, and he specifically speaks of sickness, he says, come together. Don't feel like you have to carry this on your own. You see, this idea of being raised up, the Lord will raise him up, that doesn't necessarily simply physical. Because you can pray for someone in their sickness or in their infirmity, and the grace of God can raise them up. And they may be healed, and praise the Lord for that, but they may not be. And in their lack of physical healing, there can be a demonstration of God's power through his people that gives honor and glory to him in a way that wouldn't have been done otherwise. Don't just carry your burden by yourself. Don't try to be tough. Don't try to be a lone ranger. God gave us a church family for a reason. Let's pray for each other. I can't go there for lack of time, but as I was studying this week in John chapter 17, the prayer of Jesus as he prayed for his people, he talked about that they would be one, that he may be glorified in them. You see, the glory of God, in a sense, is way too huge and way too big and way too amazing to be fully manifested in just one of us. There's something about when God's people can come together in unity and in harmony and in harmony and love and togetherness. That's a miracle. When you think of the differences that we have and the opinionatedness of how we can be, and when God's people can put those differences aside and say, I love you, let's pray for this individual, let's pray together, let's lock arms together, there's something that when the world witnesses that, it brings honor and glory to the Lord. And when you read the prayer of John 17, it's a prayer for unity among the believers. And may God help us to answer this call to come together and pray. We are certainly surrendered to the Lord when it comes to what we ask for. And one author wrote this. He says, prayer is surrender. Surrender to the will of God and cooperation with that will. If I throw out a boat hook from the boat and catch hold of the shore and pull, do I pull the shore to me? Or do I pull myself to the shore? Prayer is not pulling God to my will, but the aligning of my will to the will of God. That's good. Amen. By the way, I just want to briefly touch on verse 16. He says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. There's something, too, when there's sin in our lives that hinder our prayers. We need to make things right. We need to make things right with the Lord. And sometimes there is confession that needs to be done between one another. Maybe it's something we've done to be a poor testimony to someone. Or maybe it's something we're struggling in our life that we need help and accountability. Confess your faults one to another and ye may be healed. And there is a healing that comes when we are willing to be open and humble and vulnerable with one another. I'm not your priest, and we're not a priest to one another. And I'm not saying you just unload all your struggles in life on people. But there are circumstances where the Lord leads us to do these things so that we can have the healing we need in our Christian life. A couple of quotes I read, confession of sin is not an admission of defeat, but the first step in living in light of redemption's victory. And then this was a blessing. God will expose your sin, not to condemn you, but to draw you near, cleanse your heart, empower you to obey, and in so doing, transform your living. That's what it's about. It's not about crushing somebody under the weight of their faults and failings. It's about lifting them up to have them be all that God wants them to be. Number three, prayer for the nation. Verse 17, Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Oh, there's so much I want to say here about this. Pray. Perhaps this is speaking of a nation as a whole. Perhaps this is speaking of a local prayer. Pray for your community. Pray for America. Pray for your representatives. Pray for Israel. Pray for the foreign field. Every once in a while, get out a map and think about where our missionaries are. Pray for them. You see, your prayers can make a difference. Elijah's prayers affected the weather in his nation and provided rain. And our nation needs showers of blessing. Our community needs rain. And that may be literal and that may be spiritual. But we need the rain of God to fall. And believer, your prayers can be effectual. Maybe at times you have prayed and you've prayed and you get discouraged and you don't see something change. You don't see it make a difference. But don't stop praying. Keep praying. Be persistent. Elijah was a man just like us. Jesus said, your prayers can move mountains. And there may be mountains figuratively in your life that you say, this couldn't possibly change. Don't lose faith. Keep praying. Prayer can make a difference. It's interesting in verse 17 and 18, it talks about how Elijah prayed, and then in verse 18 it says, he prayed again. And he prayed again. And he prayed again. And Christian, sometimes that's what we need to do. We need to pray again. Number four, prayer for the straying. Verse 19, brethren, if any of you do err from the truth and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. James doesn't specifically speak of prayer in these verses, but I believe as we take it in the context here that we can see it implied. Who is it that you know that's not where they ought to be? Pray for them. Pray for them. There is nothing that makes us love a man so much as pray for him. We all know someone who used to serve, who used to be faithful, who used to prioritize God. Let me encourage you, Christian, rather than judge or criticize, get off your high horse. Realize that if it wasn't for the grace of God, where you would be. Pray for that person. 18-year-old Hudson Taylor, who would become a missionary to China and founder of China Inland Mission, wandered into his father's library and read a gospel tract. He couldn't shake off its message. Finally, falling to his knees, he accepted Christ as a Savior. Later, his mother, who had been away, returned home. When Hudson went to tell her the good news, she said, I already know. 10 days ago, the very day on which you tell me you read the tract, I spent the entire afternoon in prayer for you until the Lord assured me that my wayward son had been brought into the fold. Don't give up praying. Those people that have wandered far away from God, it's difficult to come back. There's a barrier. And the longer they stay away, the harder it is for them to make that step in. And you don't know what's going on in their heart. And they may want to, and they may long to. But they feel that fence in the way. And what we need to do as Christians is to do everything we can to remove that fence. That they might know that they're loved. That they might know that we would welcome them back with open arms. Pray. Who is it that God might lay upon your heart this week to make a phone call, to send a text, to send an email, to send a note? Let's not shame them. That's not how God works. Let's love them back to spiritual health. Amen. Does God smell the aroma of your prayers today? Early African converts to Christianity were earnest and in regular and private devotions. Each one reportedly had a separate spot in the thicket where he would pour out his heart to God. Over time, the paths to these places became well-worn. As a result, if one of these believers began to neglect prayer, it was soon apparent to others. They would kindly remind the negligent one, brother, the grass grows on your path. Let's pray. Father, I do pray that you'd help us not to allow the grass to grow on the path of our prayer life. May we be a dependent people. May we be a prayer for a people. Praying in our affliction, in our health issues, for our nation, for our wayward. Lord, give us a revival of prayer. If you'd stand, please, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. If the Lord spoke to your heart this morning, in a moment, she's going to play a hymn of invitation. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you don't have access yet to the throne of grace, but you can have it and a moment of faith. We can have someone take a Bible and show you how you can have a relationship with God, how you can have the privilege of prayer. If you're not sure you have a relationship with God, I want to encourage you to come forward today as others come forward and let me know. We can have someone take a Bible and share with you how you can do that. If the Lord spoke to your heart this morning as the piano plays, the altar is open. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you again for the privilege of coming to you. Help us, Lord, to take advantage of that and to walk with you closely on a daily basis, to have not just a prayer time, but a prayer life. May it be so in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today. You have a wonderful afternoon.